The Lord be with you.
Let us pray. O God of peace, who has taught us that in returning in rest we will be saved, in quietness and in confidence will be our strength. By the might of your Spirit, lift us, we pray, to your presence, where we may be still and know that you are God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Well, good morning. It's good to see you all. I'm glad that you're here, and glad that we can take a few minutes to talk about something that is an emotion that all of us share, all of us have to deal with in one way or another from the moment that we are born until the moment that we die. And it might seem a little bit odd in this season of celebration and of joy as we're still working our way through Easter to be talking about fear. But if you have already been to church today, or if you're going to the next service, you have heard or you will hear this. Jesus himself stood among the disciples and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought they were seeing a ghost. And he said to them, "Why are you frightened, and why do doubts arise in your hearts?" That was not the first time that appearance, post-resurrection appearance, was not the first time that Jesus had talked about fear and about being afraid and had counseled people to not be afraid. And I'm going to talk a little bit about that. But I thought it might be helpful for us to, during this season, to think about the emotion that we see that all of those who, in one way or another, experience what happened to Jesus after his death, went through, and then many of those who experienced him after his resurrection went through, and that is fear. In all four accounts of the resurrection in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, there's some reference, either directly or indirectly, to fear. To those who went into the tomb and discovered that it was empty and encountered some sort of divine, heavenly, angelic being who said to them, who tried to help calm their fears, or who left and were so startled and so afraid that they didn't really know what to say. But in all four accounts in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John of what happened after Jesus' resurrection, there's some reference to fear. And to that fear needing to be alleviated in some way in order for them to be able to move on and to understand what had happened. And then as we hear today, there were those who actually then experienced Jesus in some way who were fearful or who were terrified. So before I say any more, I'm going to say something, but then I hope you'll respond also. I want you to just think for a minute. Again, because this is something that we've all experienced, we all continue to experience every day in some way. As you probably know, there have been a lot of studies on fear, on the emotion of fear, and on how, for many of us, and for most of us at times, it can almost be paralyzing. That our fear is what keeps us from becoming all that God has intended for us to be, or that God wants us to be, that emotion, and that being able to deal with that in a positive way and to work through it is helpful not only to our emotional well-being, but to our spiritual well-being, to our connection with God and with living into what God has created for us to be and wants us, and the type of life that God wants us to live. So I want us to just think, and then as you're comfortable, just to share a little bit, if you would, about a time in your life when you can remember being afraid or being terrified. And I'm happy to start. As many of you know, or some of you may know, right after college, I became involved in law enforcement and worked for several years as a police officer and then became a detective. And one Sunday, I was having lunch with my wife, Lisa, and we were called out to respond to a situation where someone had taken his wife and his children basically hostage in their home in a very nice part of the city in which we worked, and there had been some threats that he had made to those that he'd been talking to, but he'd not been able, but there'd been no communication for quite some time, and so we were all called out to go into the home. And we had a pretty good idea that some shots had already been fired. So as we got ready to go in to the lower part of the house, in through the basement, we knew that there were several. We had to go from the basement to the main floor to the top floor. And as we began to just kind of assemble and develop our plan as how we were going to move in, I realized all of a sudden that I was terrified. Knowing that this was a very dangerous situation in which we knew that shots had already been fired, and that we had to go from where we were up to the top level, and that we were pretty much at the mercy of this person who was at that top level. So as we moved our way through the basement, we looked up, and we could see holes that had been made in the basement through the shots, some of the shots that had been fired. And it was, even though I'd been in other situations somewhat similar to that before, had gone into the unknown many times, it was terrifying. It was terrifying because it was the unknown, and we had no idea what to expect when we finally got up to where he was and they were, and it was not good. But that sense of wanting to just flee and to run was almost overwhelming and almost overpowering. Anyone else?
When our middle daughter was about 4 or 5, she came home from preschool, was dropped off, and went outside to play. And then I suddenly realized I hadn't seen her in a little bit, went looking for her. I was pregnant with our last child, and pretty pregnant, and I ended up calling and calling and calling and running and running, and I called the police, and they came and they took her description, and we tried to figure out. And it was in a period of time when a number of children had been abducted. And I've never been so afraid in my life. And I thought I would lose the other baby as well from the sheer terror. And it was horrible. She was eventually found. She was sick. She was behind the couch.
Thank you.
Both of the other two people spoke and talked about things which is what I would call fear. What I capture is the word afraid. And I realized when I started to think, well, what would one thing be? I thought that I've got lots of things I'm afraid of every day. I'm afraid I'm not going to be able to get out of bed by myself. But seriously, I had back surgery, and for the last 3 months, I haven't been able to. But this morning, I did. I mean, really, huge, huge, huge. You know, I'm afraid Jim's going to die. I'm afraid my granddaughter isn't going to make it through high school because she's so influenced by her peers. I mean, there's just so many things. And I worry about our community. Read the front page of the paper of St. Louis. I'm desperately afraid of that and how we're all going to get together. And then I thought, well, how do I get through all those things?
Dudley, I had my own thing I wanted to say, but I do want to quote from the Ferguson Commission. The Ferguson Commission. The only way forward is through. But David, to research on fear, because we also think of the connection between fear and trauma and people being triggered, and we think of flight, fight, freeze, or a new one I heard was fawn, which I think of, I'm going to use everyday jargon, sucking up to someone as a way to neutralize a threat. I'm a fight person. So one story is that the day after Parkland, I was in clinic, and I had seen a patient for her first prenatal visit, and we would say medically her affect was so restricted, it just meant her face was, she was very closed in, she was barely talking, and she actually had severe psychiatric conditions. And so I saw her for the first visit. She had a 4-year-old child with her. And I went into my office afterwards to write the note, and I'm about as far as Kathy is from the waiting room. And all of a sudden, this huge fight erupts, and we've just had Parkland the day before. And I'm the kind of person where I am running to the waiting room before I know that I'm running to the waiting room. And I was just thinking this morning that I can't say that's good or bad, because sometimes that impulse to fight is helpful and sometimes it's not helpful. It's just something I have to be aware of constantly.
Great. Thank you.
My biggest fear was in the summer of 2010, when I was first diagnosed with cancer. And it was fear that I don't think I'd ever known before in my life. And it turned me to a closer relationship with God and through prayer. And so in a funny way, that fear gave me a new avenue with which to appreciate the goodness in my, the good things in my life, as opposed to just the bad things.
Thank you.
I was terrified last night, and I was watching with my grandchild's parents and my wife. We were all together, and I don't know, my wife and my daughter went to look at something in the house, and my brother, or my son-in-law, was watching the Frozen Four on TV, and Melon, our granddaughter, was crawling around, and all of a sudden I noticed that. And I'm always entertained by watching her crawl. So she crawled across the house, and you know, I lost sight of her, and I realized that she had crawled toward the basement steps. And I thought, oh, holy cow. And it was worse than any near-death experience that I've had. And I was absolutely, I got up, and of course, the door was closed, as it was supposed to be, and she was fine. And there was, you know, and I scooped her up and brought her back and told her to watch the hockey game. So, but that scared me more than just about anything that I've ever experienced. So, that's just the most recent one. Maybe it's recency talking. I don't know.
Thank you. Anybody else? So we hear about all of those different experiences that we've had, and I think, again, it's whether we want to admit it or not, fear is something that we all deal with and have to deal with. This, do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid, is part of a conversation that is found in John's Gospel that Jesus was having with his disciples, and he was talking to them about what was going to happen to them, to him and to them. After his death. And he says, you know, do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. And then he goes on to say, do not be afraid. And it's interesting, it's always been kind of interesting to me, because this is one of the gospel lessons that is suggested as one of the readings at funerals. It's in the Book of Common Prayer, is one of the options for funerals. And it's often one that's chosen. And I've often thought that it is interesting to hear this. It's maybe comforting to hear this at a time when often our hearts are very troubled. Part of me sometimes wants to say, well, come on, Jesus. I mean, yeah, we're troubled. We're troubled today. Our hearts are very troubled. But then he goes on to help to connect that somehow with fear. So we know that fear studies have shown that it's one of the strongest driving forces in our lives. It keeps us alive. When we step into when we move into or go through those situations that are dangerous, it's that is it serotonin? Is that the endorphins, adrenaline, whatever is released chemically is what helps keep us alive. You may have heard this African proverb that talks about how when every morning in Africa, when a gazelle wakes up, it knows that it has to outrun the fastest tiger in order to stay alive. And every morning in Africa, Every morning in Africa, when a gazelle wakes up, it knows that it has to outrun the fastest lion in order to stay alive. And every morning, when a lion wakes up, it knows it has to outrun the slowest gazelle in order to not starve to death. So the proverb says that. So the bottom line is that every morning in Africa, whether you're a lion or a gazelle, when you wake up, you better be running. So this is part of what helps keep us alive, is that ability to be able to run. It's almost always fear that justifies some sort of what often can be referred to as that knee-jerk rebellion or our need to dominate. A fear that's hardly ever recognized because we're trying to act out of control. We all want to be in control, and fear takes us to that place where we're not out of control. And so we often want to move back into that place where we can be in control in some way, in some form or fashion. It's only people who have, Father Richard Rohr talks about, it's only people who've moved beyond their ego, their wounded ego and need to control everything. Only those who are able to somehow recognize that how important it is to let go, that we can see what he describes as fear being the imposter that it is. To be trapped inside of ourselves, to be trapped inside of our small ego with that desire to just to hold on and to be in control, he says, then takes us and keeps us at that point where we're most often fearful. Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, who's done extensive work on Greek death and on grieving and has written about the stages of death, says that we only have two emotions, fear and love. Love and fear. So I want to play just a little bit of a video that's called a virus called fear. Am I doing this?
Yeah, you should be.
My name is Ben Palma Jr. I'm a student documentary filmmaker. I'm making a film called A Virus Called Fear. And briefly, I was wondering if you can give me an input on how we went from having rational fear to like not getting eaten by tigers and bears, and how we came to some rational fears like politics and religion.
Okay, that's a very interesting thought.
A lot of psychologists and researchers believe that fear is an innate emotion. It's believed that we are born with the ability to be afraid because it's a survival mechanism. If we did not have fear, we would not then get into a reaction to fear, which is something that is within us to survive, to be able to properly prepare ourselves for anything that's a danger.
I think fear is a survival mechanism, certainly. Fear has adaptive qualities for us over time. We needed to be afraid of things in order to survive. So the basic fears like fear of lightning, fear of fire, fear of heights, fear of danger, fear of the saber-toothed tiger, all of those were quite functional for us. And then over time, when there was not that need to be afraid of those things because we were
perilous lives. They had been frightened of predators, lions, saber-tooths, no, probably not saber-tooths, and leopards. They would have had disease would have swooped without warning, without explanation. So they would naturally have tried to think of ways to avoid these terrible dangers. In the case of disease, which before modern science was completely unpredictable, unknowable, one would naturally fall into superstitious habits. These are superstitious responses, and when you're living in a world of ignorance.
No, it's not.
All right, so that gives us just kind of a, you know, I think a basis for thinking about the, you know, the, some of the biological and sociological and psychological foundations of fear. But we no longer know, as has been pointed out, what our foundations are. And we're not sure what's certain. And one of these people pointed out, when the world and our worldview keep being redefined constantly, then that's what creates anxiety. That's what leads us then to being fearful. When we're not sure, when the ground under us feels so unsettled, I think, Dudley, that's a little bit part of what you were trying to say a while ago, that on a daily basis, we read, we hear, we experience something that, that takes us to that point where we're just not, where we're not sure, that leads us then into being fearful. And Dudley, you also mentioned several things that you know that kind of that cause you to be fearful that many of us experience. And there is a university that does this fear survey. This is Chapman University. It's out in California, that has been studying fear for a number of years. And their most recent survey was conducted last year, in which it sampled over 1,000 adults about 97 different fears. And these were the top fears. Corrupt government officials was at the very top. Economic financial collapse. Russia using nuclear weapons. Our country becoming involved in another world war. People that we love becoming seriously ill or dying. Polluted drinking water. Biological warfare. Cyber terrorism. Not having enough money for the future. So those were the top 10. And then the list goes on down. Out of 90, again, out of 97 fears, and they label this as being a fear survey. And they've been doing these studies for quite some time, actually. I think it goes back to at least 10 years, maybe more. The key to being able to move beyond or manage our fear, again, and Richard Rohr referenced this, is being able to let go. To let go of not only control, but of our demand for certainty. And that's hard. Because we all take comfort in wanting and needing to know that how we think something will turn out will be the way that it turns out. And that is just not going to happen, is it? But that's the key. And when we don't have to control the outcome, again, this is also follows up on what Father Richard Rohr talks about. When we do not expect to predict with certainty what is by its nature uncertain, then that allows us to be free. We're able to live in a different way. Not that we're not going to continue to experience fear in some way, but when we recognize that I only have so much control, I only can be exercise certainty about some things, then we're able to live our lives in a different way. And again, Elizabeth Kubler Ross talks about fear being that which creates anger, anxiety, and guilt. And then again, she refers to there only being the two emotions, fear and love. And while love is what brings us happiness, peace, joy, contentment, fulfillment, etc., etc. But fear is what creates anger, anxiety, and guilt. And then she goes on to say that there are two opposites. There are emotions that we cannot feel, she says, at the same time. Isn't that interesting? You cannot feel fear and love at the same time. That one took me a minute to get my head around. We have a choice, then, she says, to make, fear or love. In every moment, every situation, every interaction that we have, we choose between, we're choosing between those two. So in all that we know that's so uncertain about life, all that we know about the foundation underneath us, all that we know about the world constantly changing, you know, what happened yesterday? The country of Iran attacks Israel for the first time in a much more hostile and intentional way. So day to day, sometimes hour to hour, we just never know what's going to happen, do we? The world is filled with uncertainty. So in all that is so uncertain about this life that God has so wonderfully and generously and graciously given to us to live, and at those times when we do experience anxiety and we are afraid, then the promise of hope that we're celebrating right now comes to us because of and through Jesus Christ. Do not be afraid, Jesus said over and over and over again. Gareth Higgins talks about understand your fear, and you may find that we're all just trying to figure out how to love. That our fear is what can help define what is really, as he goes on to say, what we really care about, what's really important to us. Look beneath your fear, he says, and discover what it is that really matters to you, that you're really passionate about, and what you wish to protect. People, places, things, your hopes, your dreams, whatever. Our neighborhood, our country, the environment, whatever it is, look beneath what it is that's causing you to be afraid, and you'll see what you really care about, what's really important to you. Brother James Kester is a monk with the Society of St. John the Evangelist, is an Episcopal community of monks in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and he talks about how we're afraid of so many things. The incredible thing, he says, is what happens when we stop listening to the voices in our head that are telling us to be afraid. And sometimes I would flesh that out a little bit, not only the voices in our head, but all those voices around us, all those voices that say, this is what we should be concerned about, this is what you should be afraid of, this is what you should anticipate is not going to end well. Look what happens, he said, when instead we listen to God, who tells us, do not be afraid. So in the Bible, there are almost 150 times when there is some reference to that, to not being afraid. 150 times, that's a lot. There's a lot of things that the Bible doesn't even come close to saying anything about at that level. And these are just a few. In John's gospel, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you, not as the world gives do I give to you, let not your hearts be troubled, don't let them be afraid, Jesus says. And then again, in Matthew's gospel, we hear Jesus saying, don't be anxious about your life. And then again, in Matthew's gospel, do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. And the prophet Isaiah says, fear not, I am with you. Be not dismayed, I am your God. 2 Timothy, for God gave us a spirit not of fear, but of power and love and self-control. Psalm 34, I sought the Lord, he answered me and delivered me from all my fears. Psalm 56, when I'm afraid, I put my trust in you. So that's what? 7 out of the 150 times when there's some reference to fear. And especially, you know, when you think about the Psalms, and the Psalms were written as songs of lament and praise, and as a way of talking to God over and over again. People were talking about how their connection to God and their relief of fear was through their connection with God. When I'm afraid, I put my trust in you. So last year, our bishop, Dion Johnson, wrote this about fear. Fear is alluring, he says. It speaks loudly. It deludes and distracts us with the quick fix and easy answers. Faith, he goes on to say, on the other hand, goes on forever. Faith is the long, steady, often slow and winding path that's messy and takes time and intentionality. We often choose fear over faith because it's easy and seemingly safe. God calls us always to faith over fear. And that has, I think, something to do with that issue of control. We can fall into that need and want for certainty and for control, which is sometimes easier than to go back to what the psalmist was saying, when I'm afraid, I'll put my trust in God. I put my trust in you, God. I sought God. He answered. God answered me and delivered me from all my fears. God always calls us to faith over fear. So I'm not much of a country music person, but I like this some of the words of this song written by Zach Williams, where he describes fear as being a liar and something that will take your breath away and that stops you in your tracks. He says, fear will rob your rest and steal your happiness because, though, he goes on to say, fear is a liar. So I'm going to play a little bit of this, a little bit of his song for us to listen to. So, cast your fear in the fire, because he is a liar. I kind of like that. Even though I don't like country music a whole lot, I like that sentiment. Your thoughts? Comments?
Fear is a liar, but I'd like to know more about the why, especially when it comes to, I was reviewing this book called Being White, something like that, and it's rather complicated. It's sometimes not easy to get to what the fear is really about, and especially when it comes to race relations. And that's from the book on being white.
So help me with what's your question?
Why does fear go to deceit? Fear go to deceit. Why does fear go to a place of lying?
Yes.
Why does it go to a place of what?
Lying.
Of lying?
That's the question.
Yeah. And you also said when you look under your fear, you see what you care about. I thought that was okay.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think when we're talking about that, the one issue of race relations and of our very, you know, disturbing past with some of that, I mean, to me, that's a lot. So much of that was generated by fear.
But it's still present.
Right. But I think the fear led to our continuing to want to, it was also about control, too, right? So then when you've got fear and control and not being willing to let go of those two things, then I think that has contributed largely to where, you know, historically where we were, have been, and still are. You know. Sometimes I think if we could get beyond our, I mean, you think about it. I mean, how often when you're in conversations about that particular issue, and there, of course, there are many issues, but that particular issue, how often is it that if you have a group, especially in where we only have two African-Americans in here today, if you have a group of only white people in a room and somebody says, well, how often do you interact with a person who's not white? Then it's almost always the vast majority of people in the room. So when you can't get beyond that, that leads to fear, to and our continued desire to want to exercise control.
One thing that helps me is that fear is an acronym. Forgetting everything is all right. I like that.
That's just because you forget a lot.
Well, I think of fear as necessary for protection. I moved out of my house because of the robberies on a couple of sides of where I was. So I think fear is important.
And I think that's exactly what we heard in that video, A Virus Called Fear, where there is this one of the people there pointed out, we do need fear to be able to survive. Again, that's the African proverb of the gazelle and the lion, you know. But it's when fear consumes us or we're not able to experience the other emotion, love.
I'll give the other side of my first comment of how I get through it. Mostly fear for me is when I'm aware I'm afraid of something, it's a stimulant. It raises the fact that I need to do something or have a different response. So, you know, not being able to get out of bed, you know, I've had PT and some recognition that I'm more limited in what I can do now for a while. And acceptance. The second one, I think, worried about Jim dying. I mean, they said it gave him 6 months, but that was 6 years ago. So after the initial fear of the disaster of his pending 6-month death, you know, you kind of say, okay, well, what's really important and what we've got left? And so for 5 years, I've had an incredible experience with him. You know, every day, you know, it's a blessing. It moves me, and I get a lot out of it. For things like the city of St. Louis or any other kind of things, like the homeless at Trinity, I kind of think, okay, that is a problem, but there's a way to ameliorate, get involved, support, change, and bring other people along. And that's just sort of how I live my life these days.
Great, thank you.
You know, I'm compelled to say that
fear produces exemplary performance. That situation that you described you were in, I can describe one. 200 feet, 130 miles an hour in a 140,000-pound airplane and nothing in sight. So, you know, it's not fear, but the fear is, please, God, don't let me screw this up.
He was a pilot.
Right.
And that's, I think, what fear does. There's no atheist in a cockpit, believe me.
Right.
So I'm trying to wrap up in my own thinking, and I do think it's that place of uncertainty that's the place that can tip fear easily, and it's learning how to tilt towards love when we're uncertain.
What concerns me, and back to what I was talking about before, is people who don't understand their fear, that don't even understand they have a fear.
Who aren't willing to claim that, hold on to that. And I think, you know, back to the issue about love is takes us to what Jesus was saying. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Then followed by that, believe in God. Believe in God. Believe also in me. And again, he was talking about that in the context of death, of his death, and of what was going to happen to them with the uncertainty of where they would be after he was no longer with them. So again, I don't think that what we hear, what we know about fear is that fear does motivate us to do certain things, but it's when we live with troubled hearts, I think is that becomes the issue. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. All right, thank you all for your input in this. Good to be with you. God bless you.